Let's translate some of these insights into what we call the inverse power method. And here's the idea. If we have eigenvalues ordered from largest to smallest, and this time we say that the smallest one is strictly smaller than the next smallest one in magnitude, then if these are the eigenvalues of matrix A, then the eigenvalues of matrix A inverse have the property that 1 divided by m minus 1 is the largest in magnitude, and so forth. Now, what does that mean? Well, if we execute the power method, but we do so with A inverse, then we get the exact same effect as we did when we iterated with matrix A, except that this time we will home in on the eigenvector associated with the largest eigenvalue of matrix A inverse, which then is the eigenvector associated with the smallest eigenvalue of matrix A. Okay? And then obviously, in order to keep this vector from either getting too long or too short, we would want to scale it again to keep its length, for example, equal to 1. Now, in analyzing that, we get exactly what we had before, except that lambda is replaced by lambda inverse. And then here, what I have done is I've written our vector v0 as a linear combination of the columns of x, but now I ordered them from the eigenvector associated with the smallest eigenvalue to the eigenvector associated with the largest eigenvalue. These are then the coefficients associated with those terms. And if we've already hit our vector v k times with matrix A inverse, then we end up with this expression right here. And what we notice is that these terms here will either grow or shrink faster than the first term, and therefore eventually this term is what will dominate. Okay, and then we can express the exact same thing in matrix form as follows. Okay, in order to analyze this, then what we would do is say, instead of dividing by lambda 0, let's multiply by lambda m minus 1. In that case, we get a lambda m minus 1 to the kth power here. This first term here is replaced by 1. And these terms are all replaced by the ratios between the smallest eigenvalue in magnitude and the next smallest eigenvalue in magnitude for this term, and so forth. And the same thing then happens here. We get lambda m minus 1, lambda m minus 1, and then this term right here becomes 1. And what we notice then is that, again, we end up converging on the vector psi m minus 1 times x m minus 1. How fast do we get there? Well, how fast we get there is now dominated by the ratio of the magnitude of the smallest eigenvalue and the second smallest eigenvalue. All right? So, what we have now is the inverse power method, a method for finding the eigenvector associated with the eigenvalue that is smallest in magnitude of matrix A. And obviously, once we have that eigenvector, we can use the Rayleigh quotient to compute the corresponding eigenvalue. Now, there's one more comment I should make, and that is, we don't really want to compute the inverse of matrix A, right? If we're working with a dense matrix, then we may want to solve with matrix A. What would that involve? Well, that would involve LU with partial pivoting, for example. And obviously, we wouldn't want to do that every time through the loop. We would want to do the LU with partial pivoting up front once, and then use the factors to actually solve for the vector in the linear system. Right? Alternatively, if our matrix A is sparse, then we may want to employ any of our sparse solution methods that we looked at in previous weeks.